Welcome back to Shadow the Hedgehog. Fun little story, I'm the only one here this time, because these parts were lost. We don't know what happened to them, so we had to re-record them. We never got the fuck around to that, so I'm doing them solo, and because I have nothing to say about Shadow the Hedgehog alone, even us as a group have nothing to say anymore, we've pretty much run out of commentary, I'm going to spend this part and part 15, another part that we needed to re-record, summarizing the history of the Sonic Comics timeline as told by the Complete Sonic Comic Encyclopedia. Because I'm reading directly from the book and I'm not prepared in any way, I'm probably going to stutter a lot. So, this will probably continue into part 15. If not, I'll have to find different stuff to talk about, and I'll be reading it directly as it's said in the book. If it needs any visual aids, hopefully our editor has found the stuff that's necessary from, you know, the encyclopedia. I doubt we'll need anything visual, so let's get started. In the early 21st century, Earth received its first contact with an alien race. The Zorda ambassador was poorly received, captured and dissected. The already aggressive Zorda race declared war on Earth. The Hidden City Initiative was enacted. A handful of small cities were built out of view and protected from the impending Zorda invasion. Only a fraction of Earth's population would be saved in these self-sufficient cities. The Zorda attacked with their gene bombs. All life, plant and animal, was broken down into its most basic components. This was the end of the Earth. This may be the origin of the legendary Days of Fury. Side note, I love how the encyclopedia doesn't directly define a lot of these terms, despite, you know, being the Complete Sonic Comic Encyclopedia. Thousands of years later, the combined biomatter began to recongeal. Life arose anew out of the primordial soup. How dare you! The first life to reclaim the planet were the Mobosaurs. Their time was brief. The coming of the Chaos Emeralds. Perfect. Countless green Chaos Emeralds rained down from parts unknown and wiped out the Mobosaurs. Almost. That was a very necessary caption on there. Three managed to harness the power of the Chaos Emeralds and unlock the mysteries of the Chaos Force. These three would become the Ancient Walkers. The anthropomorphic Mobians would rise to claim the planet next. One of the most advanced were the Echidnas. The Echidnas evolved and progressed far faster than most other races on Mobius. They viewed the others as ignorant and possibly dangerous. So they moved to an island and built their utopia, Albion. Using advanced technology, they hid themselves from the rest of the world. The Albion Echidnas continued to advance and rediscovered the lost sciences. They even went so far as to travel the stars. But eventually, other Mobians would discover the power of the Chaos Emeralds. Mogul, a simple hunter, became fused with the Chaos Emerald because that can totally happen. It granted him amazing powers. Mogul used his new power to brutishly claim control of the surrounding tribes. But Mogul was ignorant of his full power and... Awesome, already started. But Mogul was ignorant of his full power, and his cruel reign was quickly overthrown. He had realized his limitations. For hundreds of years, he studied his powers and learned to control the elements. He invented crystalline magic. He prepared to take over the world. The Devious flocked to Ixis Mogul and his promise of power. In return for their loyalty, he taught them magic. They became his Order of Ixis, his army to conquer the world. Albion returned to the outside world in the form of the Templar Knights of Aurora, who have very silly armor, if you can see the art on here. If the art is showing you, I think you'd agree with me. Their advanced technology was the only thing standing between the Order of Ixis and world domination. Cue M. Bison of course clip. The power of Ixis magic versus Albion technology ravaged the planet. Bizarre creatures called mutates, altered beasts with cybernetic enhancements, began to be used by both sides. Who introduced these first is unknown. The battles shattered most budding communities. All written records around the world were destroyed, except for the ones that we apparently still have. This era became known as the Forgotten Wars. It may also have been the origin of the legendary Days of Fury. In an effort to combat the Order of Ixis, Albion sent its scientific elite to form their first colony on Down Under. Yes, that is actually what it's called. Fun fact, it's also where Vector is from. The remote research center was supposed to work miracles. Instead, they used the local populace as their test subjects. The Tasmanian Devil Tribe was transformed into vicious Mobinis known as Tasmanian Devil Dogs. The scientists were arrested and convicted of their crimes. The Order of Ixis would be defeated not long after, and the world returned to peace. But the Tasmanian devils were forever changed, producing more devil dogs than babies. Soon their kind would be all but forgotten, and the Mobinis were thought to be the norm. And yes, but they actually are called Mobinis. I might be pronouncing it wrong, but that's just what my brain immediately looks. It's M-O-B-I-N-I-S. My brain just defaults to Mobini. Might be Mobini, but you know, that just sounds weird. Hundreds of years would pass before Albion would attempt another colony. This colony had no centralized purpose beyond spreading echidna culture. So wasted resources. They first settled in Samerica, but ran afoul of the Felidae in the Pais Mysterioso. Pretty sure I mispronounced that. Most opted to relocate, but two of the castes stayed to fight for the land. The warrior caste became the Knuckles Clan, led by Chief Pachacamac, actually his name. They evoked the Wrath of Chaos and were destroyed. You probably remember them from the first Sonic Adventure, you know, with the call and everything. The Advanced Sciences caste became the Nocturnus Clan. They were transported to the Twilight Cage by unknown means and preserved themselves with their advanced technology. You might remember them from Sonic Chronicles The Dark Brotherhood. Actually, you probably don't, because that game's story was really, really forgettable. The remainder of the colonists settled on Down Under, where they would erect Echidnaopolis, original name. Generations later, the brilliant scientists Jordan and Kayla Law discovered the Great White Comet and its crash course with their city. The Echidna scientists used the power of the Chaos Emeralds to lift the surrounding land into the sky. The resident fire ants helped to dig the landmass free. Thus, the floating island was created. It wouldn't be renamed as Angel Island for hundreds of years after Jordan and Kayla Law's granddaughter, Angel Law. Fun fact about Echidna society, the females always have two names. I don't know why, but they do. Generations later, the brothers Edmund and Dimitri formed a plan to drain the power of the Chaos Emeralds and return Angel Island to the surface of Mobius. Dimitri went against the government and attempted the risky plan. He was transformed into Enerjack and buried under his own tower lair, in one of the most hilarious moments of the comic's history. All-powerful godlike being, can't lift rocks. He was trapped under those rocks for 400 years. All-powerful being, can't lift rocks. Edmund was named the first guardian and was assassinated shortly into his tour of duty. Steppenwolf took over his father's position as guardian and was trained in the ways of the Chaos Force by Christopheles. That is still just a weird name. He's a good guy, but his name is really close to Mephistopheles. Menaker founded the Dark Legion, convinced he was doing the will of his late father. Steppenwolf used his powers to banish the Dark Legion into the Twilight Cage. Fun fact, the Twilight Cage is sometimes called the Twilight Zone. The Dark Legion would attempt to return to the floating island for many generations afterward. Over the years, the resident Dingoes slowly stole and adapted much of the Echidna technology. This built tensions between the two sides, which led to violence. Listen to the overkill here, rather. The Dingo regime launched nuclear missiles at Echidnaopolis. Although the attack was foiled, the resulting fallout threatened to poison the entire island. No shit. Maybe nuclear missiles weren't such a good idea. Great job, Dingoes. Guardian Hawking, first name Steven, I presume, used the Hyperzone Projector to preserve each society on the island within its own different dimension. The Brotherhood of Guardians oversaw the cleanup of the next... Let me just start that sentence over. The Brotherhood of Guardians oversaw the cleanup of the island over the next few hundred years. Man, 10 minutes am I this far in? I'm going to actually make it through in this part. During this period of time, the visionary Alexander Acorn began negotiating with and uniting the many different Mobian communities. All were welcome in his new society. The rapidly advancing Overlanders began defining their borders and distancing themselves from the animals to the south. And animals is in quotation marks, by the way, even though they are literal animals. Okay, two more and then the truth. The Overland came together, and the magistrates recognized the first Overlord. That's how you know they're evil. For his efforts, Alexander was named king of his new city of Mobotropolis. He became the first in the Acorn lineage. He promoted peace and acceptance, strength through diversity.
The Black Comet?
The Overland tore into their lands, mining for the minerals they needed for their advanced technology and to support their growing military. I think I might have skipped a page. A host of events led to mounting tensions. The Overland squandered their resources on the 100 Moons of Mobius project, which produced such orbital stations as the Ark, which is the only one that matters. Prince Emerson Acorn, the third in the Acorn line, was accidentally assassinated by Overlander nobility. I think I might have said Prince Emerson the Acorn. Whoops, if I did. The Overland became more aggressive, actively seeking new resources. They even went so far as to ally themselves with the Dark Legion and plot the conquest of the floating island. Finally, after hundreds of years of tension, Overlord Charlemagne gained full support for his plan to conquer the rich lands of the Kingdom of Acorn in the name of the Overland. Their superior technology and more violent ways saw to a swift conquest. The capital city of Mobotropolis had fallen to them by 3220. Queen Alicia and Prince Elias Acorn were evacuated to the royal compound on Angel Island. They were hidden away by the Brotherhood. To make matters worse, within the southern baronies conspired with the Overland to fight the oppressive Kingdom of Acorn. The tide of the war changed when Dr. Julian Kintobor defected from the Overland and petitioned the Kingdom of Acorn for asylum. With Julian's genius, the Kingdom of Acorn gained the weaponry and tactics they needed to rout the Overlander forces, reclaim the capital, and make the war even more costly for the aggressors. Make them spend as much money as possible. Julian also negotiated the final duel between King Maximilian Acorn and Overlord Charlemagne to decide the outcome of the war. King Acorn won and banished all Overlanders from his realm. The Overland became divided. Some tried to maintain their resource-starved cities. Magistrate Colin Kintobor Sr. led some on a space colonization effort. Others resettled in the United Federation. Overlord Charlemagne disappeared. He's definitely dead now. Meanwhile, Mobotropolis and the Kingdom of Acorn flourished. During the brief year of peace, Julian saw to it that former warlord Kodos and former royal wizard Ixis Nagus were trapped in the Zone of Silence. With his nephew Snively at his side, he prepared his coup d'etat. Becoming Dr. Ivo Robotnik. It's impossible for me to say Robotnik, like the full thing, without the way AOSTH Robotnik did it. Becoming Dr. Ivo Robotnik, he used the technological gifts he had given to his host country to seize it from within. King Maximilian Acorn was banished to the Zone of Silence. Zone of Silence is the go-to banishment place. Only a handful of the royal court managed to escape. Mostly the women, children, and civilians managed to escape the initial takeover. That's a little redundant, actually. No, never mind. No, it isn't. I'm an idiot. They hid out in the secluded village of Knothole, originally meant as a retreat for the royal family. The straggling remains of the army attempted to retake the city. They were defeated and roboticized. Good job, guys. The survivors banded together to form the original Freedom Fighters and set the groundwork for those who would follow. They were betrayed by one of their own, roboticized, and lost forever to the Zone of Silence. By the way, we don't hear much about the original Freedom Fighters. Like, I think that's the only mention of them ever. I think maybe they might have mentioned them a few times in other issues, but now they just don't exist because reboots. Sir Charles Hedgehog maintained his chili dog stand for as long as he could, but even he was captured and roboticized. Now we're getting into a point that, you know, most of you might recognize. Following the example set by their elders and using the networks, they had established the next generation of Freedom Fighters. The next generation of Freedom Fighters took up the battle against Dr. Robotnik. And this is the Freedom Fighters you probably know. The Freedom Fighters made small surgical strikes against Dr. Robotnik to slow his conquest of Mobius, and to find out what happened to King Acorn. It was really dumb. They had many adventures trying to liberate their roboticized loved ones and combating Dr. Robotnik's menacing machines. I love alliteration. The first Robotnik War ended with Sonic the Hedgehog and Dr. Robotnik's final duel in his own fortress. Thanks to Snively's treachery, the Doctor was destroyed by his own weapon, the Ultimate Annihilator. Yeah, Robotnik died once. It was a good story, too. The war orphans had completed their mission. The king was rescued, their city reclaimed, and Dr. Robotnik was overthrown. The future looked bright. However, Ixus Nagus managed to escape the Zone of Silence and wanted the Kingdom of Acorn and the world for himself. Again, QM Bison clip. He spread his own brand of chaos before fleeing to the world at large. Sonic the Hedgehog and Tails the Fox tracked him across Mobius and managed to seal him back in the... Managed to seal him back in the Zone of Silence with the help of the exiled Nate Morgan. Both the Freedom Fighters and the Chaotix would have to pull out all the stops to stop Mammoth Mogul from another attempt at world domination. All the while, Dr. Ivo Eggman Robotnik observed from his secret assembling Egg Satellite base. Meanwhile, on the floating island, Guardian Knuckles faced the latest return of the Dark Legion. The effects of the Ultimate Annihilator neutralized the effects of the Hyper Zone Projector, returning Echidnopolis to the island and exposing Knuckles to his secret heritage that no one told him about for reasons I don't even think they ever explained. The Dingo regime was also returned, but with their city destroyed, they had nowhere to go. They had to be pacified before they were integrated into Echidnopolis's working class. And Knuckles was ultimately reunited with his father, Locke, and told the truth of the Brotherhood of Guardians, who don't exist anymore. Because reboots. Knuckles also learned of the Lost Tribe. Echidnopolis citizens who spent generations searching for their homeland of Albion. The Guardian also assisted their spiritual Mitre and Yanar in escorting the Lost Tribe through Mercia, and teamed up with Archer hero Rob O. the Hedge, and it's O apostrophe. He's a green Sonic, but he's not Scourge, by the way. Eventually, they reached the hidden city of Albion, where the Lost Tribe finally settled after their long exodus. Knuckles returned to the floating island to watch it and its new Master Emerald, which contained the spirit of the defeated Mammoth Mogul. That's right. In the comics, Knuckles actually does his damn job. I feel like I talked about a lot of this in the Sonic 06 commentary, which is already recorded, but, you know, this is probably going up before that, so it'll just be redundant there. The Second Robotnik War... good words. The Second Robotnik War began when Dr. Robotnik Mark II traveled from a parallel future to conquer Mobius Prime. Because, remember, this is still comic books. He reclaimed all of the freed Mobians to work for him. Oh, Robians. Yeah, Robians. Robians is, by the way, the default word for roboticized Mobians. Creative. His advanced Shadowbot army marched on the capital and reclaimed Robotropolis for their master. The Freedom Fighters managed to destroy Robotnik's satellite base, but it was only a temporary setback. The fully robotic Robotnik... try saying that. I feel like that'd be a tongue twister. The fully robotic Robotnik downloaded his mind into a robot shell, bringing out his new Eggman look. And by the way, and thanks to the reboot, I don't think this is the case anymore. He's just always looked like that. But you know, before the reboot, Eggman was totally a robot. Soon, Dr. Ivo Eggman Robotnik launched his plan to revive chaos. He shattered the Master Emerald and used its shards to feed the weakened God of Destruction. As the Freedom Fighters investigated the case, they were introduced to Station Square. The United Federation would slowly be forced out into the open from this point on. The Spirit T'Kall, who was trapped with Chaos, tried to warn Knuckles and the outside world of the impending doom and try to prevent a repeat of history. Although things grew dire, the Freedom Fighters managed to defeat Chaos, Dr. Eggman, and prevent a total disaster. Well... sort of. Chaos still kind of destroyed Station Square, but, you know, details. Knuckles' latent chaos powers began to develop too rapidly thanks to meddling by Dimitri and the Dark Legion. Chaos Knuckles was unleashed on Mobius. Chaos Knuckles, by the way, is just Green Knuckles. And the reason he has latent chaos powers? His father, like, experimented on him when he was a kid with science, and he... became, like, irradiated with chaos energy. It's weird. The forces of Albion attempted to rein in his power, but Chaos Knuckles proved to be too much. The attempts to capture and depower him wound up creating the devious Dr. Finitivus, who probably can't be used anymore. We don't know. Dimitri coached Knuckles, who in turn tried to use his powers to rewrite all of time. When that failed, he championed the Dark Legion's return to Echidna society, with limited success. Knuckles was forced to unleash all of his power on Mammoth Mogul to save Dimitri, who also doesn't exist anymore, which sucks because Dimitri was one of my favorite characters. Dude was awesome. Knuckles appeared to die while Mogul would gain enough power to mortally wound the Ancient Walkers. Remember them? We mentioned them like once. Sure I didn't skip a page. I'm always paranoid that I do. This last page might be all we can really do for the rest of this part. Meanwhile, the Overlanders who fled to space to colonize New Worlds so many years ago returned to Mobius. After escaping Dr. Eggman's clutches, they settled in the United Federation. Not long after, more visitors came from space. The Zorda had returned to check up on Earth, only to find it teeming with life. The aliens decided that Mobius had to be destroyed because they're assholes, I guess. I haven't actually read the story where they show up again, so I don't know if they have a legitimate reason other than just fuck you. Mobius united to drive off the invasion, but the Zorda dropped their greatest weapon, the Quantum Dial. It would transform planet Mobius into a black hole, destroying all life as well as the planet itself. Wasn't that the Triceraton's plan at the... at the end of Season 3 of Ninja Turtles, basically? Jeez. Huh. Sonic used his super speed to inert the power of the device. It neutralized the weapon, but flung Sonic across the galaxy in an instant. Have you ever went fast? Sonic did once, and he got launched across the fucking universe. Or galaxy, rather. But... since this part is almost over, that's, I think, going to be it for part 6. This is going to be continued in part 15. So, finally, yeah. The Chaos Emeralds. The comics are weird sometimes, but we are nearing the end of there, so I'm going to have to find different stuff to talk about.
Why are you siding with them?
I'll figure something out. But, you know, in the meantime, look at this last cutscene, man. It's the same ending we've seen like 3 times. Like, animation-wise, it's got, you know, the Chaos Emeralds and everything, man. I think Shadow's even got the same, like, movements. They just kind of put him here. And Jason Griffith's shitty Shadow really does kind of shine here. Like, at its worst. That's the end of part 6. End of part 6. End of part 6. End of part 6.